first works, the role of students' self-actualization in adapting to the learning, e-learning environment.
Ensure the formation of productive agreed for adaptation to the advanced learning environment. According to the result of the study, of the self-authorization level of the first year student on the basic scale, others concluded that the level of independence in the assessment in the environment is insufficient. The low average level of self-authorization indicates the need to supervise the first year student in choose learning trajectories in online environment. A comparative study shows that young people majoring in engineering have a higher level of self-authorization than young people are majoring in humanities. The result of the study on the additional scale of cognitive needs allowed us to conclude that the young people majoring in engineering are intellectually more adapted to the expansion of an education environment and self-actualization of knowledge is in different areas. So obtained results are a practical importance for modeling the education environment and personalization of online learning in higher education. They can be used in the development of individual education rules and profit programs. Thank you.
Let's go with the third presentation of the morning. That will be presented by Marisa Saint-Salute, that will be the paper entitled Impact of the Indicators of Educational Innovations Based on Active Methodologies. I remember you that you have 10 minutes.
All the pressure. Thank you.
You can stop now.
Oh my God. Oh, wow. This is not bad. Okay. I'm going to talk about the impact indicators of educational innovation based on active methodology. The idea is that currently the teaching educational innovation is local and they are applied in the context of each subject. It implies that it's very difficult to transfer good practices between different subjects. There are a lot of repetitions of experiences and it produces a slow progress to obtain a global persistence. So the educational model is improved very slowly. We propose a model that they call TEEM'19. It's a method for the application of educational innovation. And the result of the first phase of this model is the generation of common and transferable indicators. The first phase is focused on finding what is the root problem of the teaching. And the teacher has to find this. In this case, we are going to consider a specific problem, is the passive students. And the steps of the model make it easier to answer to the three different questions. How to identify the characteristics of the students in which the root problem is presented? This guy is the passive students. The question two is to identify the learning problems that students have affected by the root problem. How these passive students include this attitude, affect to the learning progress. And the third question is how to determine the indicators in order to improve this or to solve this this root problem. So in this work, we have studied, the objective is to study if university teachers share a common vision of innovations to improve the students' active participation. So we took five Spanish courses of given in four universities, Spanish universities, and one course given in a conference, an international conference in Colombia, in which universities of Colombia, Ecuador, Chile, and Mexico, have participated. We proposed these three questions, the previous questions, through three forums. And so we are going to
participants in each course. And you see here the right table and the number of answers and unique answers. They are very similar in every course, 58, 54, 56, and so on. And the progression of unique answers will go to the different answers given during the forums. And almost in the two first courses, we obtained all of the different answers. So it's a very similar opinion of the courses. And so in the results, when we analyze the types of answers, we determine different categories. And so the first one was the attitude, the general attitude of the student, of a passive student, and the proposed activities, and how the student affecting the learning knowledge, the attitude of students in the classroom, and the tutorial action. So, taking into account these categories, also we present here in the table, some tables, the two first answers of each category, the most chosen answers. So, the last column gives the number of universities or courses which are agreement with respect to this characteristic. And so you see that shows that the student shows a non-verbal language or does not participate in proposed activities or does not participate in class. It's a common idea for all the courses that it is that they are characteristics of passive students. So with respect to the impact of these characteristics of passive students in their learning, you see that there are an agreement with respect to the learning and knowledge, the last four options, and the attitude in the classroom. So does not acquire high cognitive abilities, does not the student does not need reinforcement, is influential on the active students, bad influential on the active students. And so this is the impact, I'd say, that of the passive characteristics. And the last one, the question is about the indicators of the impact of innovation to achieve active student habits. I mean, how we know that after applying our innovation, the students are active, not passive like at the beginning. And so the agreement, the total agreement is the students shows greater involvement in the learning, increases participation, and so on. And the others, four courses are agreed to these options. The conclusions common indicators must be taken to allow measuring the impact of innovation both in the local environment where the innovation was applied and globally. And so the general idea of this work is think globally and act locally, not as we currently do, we only stay in the local context. University teachers has a common vision about the characteristics, negative impact on the learning, and indicators to know if the innovation has been succeeded. So, about the characteristics of passive students, we realize that they can be categorized in two groups. The observable ones without the intervention of a teacher. You can see that they are sleeping, when the students are sleeping without asking. Okay. And from the zero reaction of students to any demand made by teachers. When you ask for participation, for a discussion, and they don't do nothing. So with respect to the impact, the three ways or the impact of the passing students implies to the own students by the motivation, the interest, and involvement on the teaching staff, because the teachers need extra effort to teach and to support the different levels of students, and to the whole teaching creating negative synergies and so on. And the last one is indicators that can measure the impact is emotional, performance, and participatory. And well, most of them, the issues are the participatory to measure. And for future work, we want to investigate more in the area of knowledge, not only for teachers of different universities, but in the area of knowledge, the subject, the course, and the education. Thank you very much. He doesn't have me. He doesn't want to the 5 minutes.
Now I will give you advice. We're going to athletics run, for example, 5 minutes, 3 minutes.
No, please.
If you prefer this one, it's the same. Like, the last.
Because I don't.
For me, okay. It's not a problem.
No. Okay. I prefer nothing.
Let's go to the second paper that will be presented by Marisa. That is entitled, this is this one, the method to propose good practice of teaching educational innovation.
Okay.
Let's go.
Thank you very much. Well, we are all also trying the method for the application of educational innovation, okay? And this method integrates procedures to develop an educational innovation experience in an effective way through indicators to measure its quality. This is the most important aspect of this model. This model is this method is composed by 4 phases. The first one is focused on the finding the root problem, or what problem we want to solve in the classroom. And the improvement indicators. And so, and the second phase is to find the most appropriate innovation method. The third one is to compose or to create all the activities for the innovation prior and during the innovation, and also to measure the success of this experience. And the last one is the dissemination through different scientific contexts. So in this case, we want to prove that the main method can be applied also to design proposals of educational innovation projects. Not only to apply the innovation, but also to prepare a proposal. So we'll have a study about an online course given to a Spanish university, with 24 university teachers as participants, and they presented a proposal of educational project at the end of the course, and all of them, well, the quality was really good, and so they passed all of the course. And we have an opinion poll that we are going to analyze. So with the first question, we wanted to know the previous experience of the participants, and you know that 10 of the participants only know the innovation from the theoretical level. And 2 of them have already applied an educational innovation project. And so, well, it's a lot of differences. The second question is trying to know the opinion of if the main method that they followed provides procedures to do all the activities, all these aspects of the main method, and in order to build the proposal of a project. So to identify indicators of improvement, select the best innovation methods, identify activities that involve more effort and why it happens, classify the activities, by teachers, students, and research, to do a schedule, to study the effectiveness, efficiency, sustainability, transferability, and how to do the dissemination of this, this proposal. These are all of the aspects that a proposal have to include. And so, and the participants think that from 1 to 5, 1 is nothing and 5 is much. They give around, in the mean, is the last column, is around 4 points, from 1 to 5. And you can see that in the, for the experience of the participants, these are the first columns, they give a value of more than 4 points. But for the theoretical level, for participants with theoretical level, they give less than 4 points. Well, it's because it's new, it's very new for them. And about the degree of difficulty, from nothing to much, with respect to each phase of this main method, about the indicators, ingredients, the innovation method, effectiveness, efficiency, all of them, and sustainability. They give from 1 to 5, they give a degree of difficulty lower than 3. It's close to 3, okay? It's in the average from 1 to 5. And we then we observe that the experienced participators give less than three points to the difficulty, but for the theoretical participants, for the theoretical level, they think it's more difficult this method, but only over 3, not too much. Okay, taking into account the different phases of this method, we see that about the efficiency of the method, main method, or of in every case, in every phase, this is close to 4, and for difficulty, close to 3. It's the same results previous, but okay, in the conclusion, so we see that about the perception of the people, of the participants, people with experience gives the value of over 4 points from 1 to 5, and for theoretical level for students is lower than 4. And about the difficulty, is with people with experience in educational innovation give a value 2.5, 2.6 to the difficulty of the phases, but with people with theoretical level gives over 3. And this study shows that the weakest point of the main method, this method, is related to the preparation of the educational innovation to be published in scientific context. It's the hardest part of a proposal, how to prepare, how to organize all of the innovation, all the proposal in order to be published, to be useful, to be published in the scientific journal and so on. And the main method can be applied. We have proven that it can be applied in the preparation of proposals of education and innovation with high possibilities of being a good practice without entailing a high effort. And so we obtain good results, good proposals, and with less effort because they have the guidelines in order to prepare. Well, we have experience of doing proposals, and sometimes we have all the ideas all together, but we have organized them. And this method helps to organize that. Okay? So, thank you very much.
You need to stop one moment and I can put one.
you agree with me, okay?
Those one on the sides. Let's go. Don't stop the music. Stay where you are. With the last paper that this morning will be presented by Marisa, that is breaking down barriers to facilitate that the university teachers create our visual learning materials. Let's hope you goodbye. We have all the time. No problem.
Okay, I think we are all of, the, of us agree in the sense of that the information and communication technologies play a fundamental role in methodological renewal of education. So this is a sentence of the Spanish Ministry of Education and Science in 2006. And all of these statements and agreements agree with the respect to this sentence. You know that currently we want every teacher that wants to apply innovation, wants to apply new methodologies. We look for new methodologies, especially in our present is active methodologies. And for this, for applying these active methodologies, we need digital competences. What happens with teachers and students? Well, you know, except the young teachers, well, when we have more, we are called digital immigrants. But our students are the digital natives, because they have been born with technologies and computers and everything, and everything is easier for them. With respect to the implication of teachers, I think they are they show interest on new methodologies to active students' learning. They also show interest on new technologies. And most of us are involved in application for educational innovation projects in local calls. Every university has local calls, and we are involved in that. But teachers have some barriers. For example, in order to apply these technologies to the new methodologies. Some barriers, for example, insufficient background, high learning effort, variety of resources and training, and changes of strategies lines of institutions. The institutions are important in this case also. So the result of this situation is frustration. Frustration is in some part of the teachers. In this case, in this work, we are going to consider a concrete thematic is the creation of audiovisual material. And we are going to study the results of surveys given to teachers, participants in six courses for training of teachers at the University of Zaragoza. And all of these courses involved in the creation of audiovisual material. In contrast with the results of these surveys for teachers, we will show you the opinion of students in similar situations of the creation of audiovisual material. The objective is to extract the needs and uncertainties of teachers. So, with respect to the qualitative results of teachers' surveys, well, they express some thesis. They say that they need more practical sessions, they need more distance courses, they need a greater contextualization of software in the teaching fields. They go in depth on audiovisual language. They want on development techniques for virtual courses, video programs, and so on. And a periodic update of these tools, because they are changing continuously. And at the end, of course, the summary of that is they need further support. In contrast, the surveys given to the students that they have a lot of experience, more every year in this first table, they saw that they have more and more experience in doing, previously in doing, in creating videos, videos, and well, in the second table, we see the presentation of work time that they need to learn how to use the technology. And you see that the first option is from 0 to 20% is most of the students, they need very few time to learn the technology. But when we ask if how the time that they need to prepare the content of the video is different, and now they need more time. For example, from 40 to okay, from 40 to 60, and well, you can see in the last green and blue graphics that they need more time to prepare the content than preparing the video. And the last one is the opinion of students with respect to the useful of the videos in order to understand the contents. So, educational institutions prepares actions, calls, training programs, but this is not enough. And also initiatives for open online learning, like open courseware and MOOCs, and so on, but this is not enough. And so, in this work, we propose a method in order to design a course, open online course, to prepare educational digital contents. And the keys are reusing contents. They study the contextualization and personalization of the contents in order to study different profiles of teachers. The simplicity. If we present difficult technology, they, of course, we have not assessing. Analytic view to guarantee the quality. And we have added some aspects that we consider important. Materials accessibility, intellectual property, and planning, plan and structure the content before using the technology. So we have applied this model to a teacher's training course for the creation of audiovisual materials that we have prepared that can will be offered in the space of open courseware at the University of Zaragoza. It will be free, open, online, and so on. And the conclusion is that this study allows us to detect in the teachers enthusiasm, compromise, and also difficulties and frustration. Also, the need of having a guide to design this kind of training by means of the model that we propose, and contrast students have find it easier to use the technology, and the technology for teachers is a better in many cases, and for future work to go deeper to the study of the needs and concerns of the educators through the course, the open course, the online course that we have prepared for the creation of audiovisual materials, following the model of the NICOM that we propose here. Thank you very much.
My name is Martino Cugiraldo, and my workshop called The Element of a Toolkit. for an entering program. Mentoring is a discipline that allows to uncover new and deeper ability that helps transform individuals that serve as a guide to improve some aspect of their lives. Whatever it is, it could be professional or personal. When it comes to using the mentoring set of skills, it's very important to understand that mentoring is focused on who mentees are and who they are relating to their own progress or ambitions. There are techniques, skills, tools that create the matrix or the environment that which the mentee will expose, communicate, develop, explore, and create their own proper relationships with the mentor, and more importantly, their own relationship with themselves. The process guide, tools, and resources in this toolkit, were based in 15 years of practices and experience that I have in the field of coaching and mentoring. While many ideas and techniques in this toolkit should be considered best practices, the idea with the mentoring program constantly improves and involves the program to reflect current business trends and mentees' needs. As a part of my doctoral studies, I embarked in the process of implementing a mentoring program, and I want to select a few mentoring programs, a few components of mentoring programs to offer a toolkit that I could be implementing initially in my process. The purpose of this toolkit is to provide guides and tools to participants in the mentoring program to increase their mentees' consciousness and responsibility to generate a high-level direction in the mentoring process. Mentoring can be taken at different forms. Traditional mentoring involves one-to-one relationship between a more experienced person with a less experienced person, in this case would be the mentee. With non-traditional mentoring, it can take different forms, such a network of different mentors. Developing a mentoring program allows to engage students, support them professionally, and we can also help them to develop and provide settings for connection with professionals and to create and embrace a local community. The toolkit was designed to streamline the process defined in achieving goals in three different stages of the mentoring program. The first one is getting acquired, the second is setting goals and objectives, and the third one is assessing and closing the mentoring program. For each of these processes, I have designed a tool and activity to help the mentee to achieve a specific goal. Each goal is related to each process and enable effective mentoring relationships, providing access to the mentors, tools, resources, evaluating results for mentoring processes, and incorporating better practices in the academic process. The table shows the stages and tools designed for each process. Each process has different goals, and each goal has a different activity, a tool that we create to achieve each goal. The first one is getting to know each other as individuals. And the activity that I create is imparting information. The activity helps us to recognize the personal background of the student, the personal goals, career goals, perspectives that they have, motivations, commitments, also recognize the skills and abilities and the hopes and interests that they have. And the last part of this is additional questions that help you to understand. Each mentor has different questions that he wants to achieve. For the goal B is sharing and agreeing with expectations. I create an activity that calls a mentor expectations. This activity helps to
to get a brief knowledge about the participants and using the process of writing and clarifying all the expectations that they have. For the goal C is clarifying roles and responsibilities and how we can help each other. I created a mentoring expectation worksheet. And this activity is a tool that helps to recognize the mentoring relationships and expectations and allow the mentors to have a clear communication with his mentee or her mentee. For the other is a guiding and mutual understanding of each other's communication and learning styles. And it's also a learning styles worksheet, and this activity is to determine methodologies of the learning and solving problems. The goal E, establishing what must be done before developing a contract, is a communication assessment. And with this tool, helps to determine the style of communication that the student wants to have. Then the stage two is setting goals and objectives. The goal F is developing goals and scope in the time frame. This tool helps to plan and reflect the personal goals that the mentee have and prepare responses to the questions of what the mentee want to be in a proper environment, working space, the personality types that they have, what is the best connection that the mentee can have in an environmental working environment, and what is the most important work value that he can or she can add to the environment, to the work environment. The other was establishing roles and expectations, and for this I create an activity that the mentees are responsible to create their own development plan, and this development plan has objectives, steps, resources, and it has a timeline and results that he or she needs to resolve. The whole H is development alternative solution or approaches to meet development needs. And this one is I created a tips of giving a for this activity, the tips are given in a special sheet to receive feedback. The goal is identifying learning activities to conduct. The activity and this tool is an action plan that allows the mentee to define which objectives want to achieve in a long term. The goal J is development an action and implementation plan. This is a mentoring session brief, and the activity is a tool to make an mentee aware of the weak and strong points of the frame and the areas that they need to work in order to elaborate the plan action and to focus in a specific topic to be developed in his or her exercise as a mentoring session. And the stage three, that is the assessing and closing, as the goal K, that is assess whatever development goals have been met, and this tool helps to identify gaps between performance and individual mentoring goals. And finally, the goal L, provide feedback to one on each other, is a final tool that helps to decide how mentees are most effective identifying areas of growth and development and consider points of view from the mentee. As a conclusion, using a toolkit, these tools can be a very helpful experience and help the mentee to be more visual, auditory, and kinesthetic in his learning, his or her learning. And finally, they help mobilize and motivate mentees when they are challenged and uncertain how to face a particular situation. Thank you.
You're welcome, Manager. And thanks for this virtual and ghost presentation. Then we have other meeting, but I prefer to change maybe the flow of the session. And now, following the same schedule that in the previous session, will be the group of photo, no, with the special presence prepared by the chair. Then we invite the speakers to push to the table to start, and the participants are okay to do that. Please come here. Thanks so much for your presentations. I think that are some type of projects, some type of ideas, very interesting. And I just want to ask about one question. What do you think about, are the faculty, are the teachers, are the students the team more interesting to develop what
to work with new systems, with new active systems. What do you think? Are the faculty, are the teachers, are the students? This is an open question. You have presence on different type of projects, on different type of results, and I am asking this question because in some issues, for example, in my case, in my faculty, I think that the faculty more or less say, I want to create some type of innovative classroom with innovative methodologies, so the problem is we don't have time to the teachers to prepare the class. Then the teachers, the second question, oh, for me, I don't have the time, I don't have the money, I don't have the resources to change my classroom, then I prefer to continue with my traditional class. And then the students, I think that they prefer no complications. And for me, it's better to learn or to work with and complete materials, but to try to connect some different type of contents using teamwork in an active way is so complex. I am not prepared. Then, for me, having a book, having a contents, study is better. And for this reason, I think that both of three main sectors, students, teachers, faculty, put problems to this type of methodology innovation. What do you think? What is that? What we need to change to the three sectors to create new methods with a successful implementation?
To work with a learning environment.
I don't know now about Russian.
Yes.
Okay.
about the access examination, the students never have access examination to go to the university. They give some data about them in this test. So we have a mark to this questionnaire that's also have information about the spread of the English study. So the idea is to do the students with public buses in the questionnaire, and also the students with English study calling English studies who make this condition. And then to offer the course to these students and say, well, it's one day or two for you, but especially for them, not for all the previous students, because we think that this is a course of this paper. For us, it's a paper resource.
I think that the main problem is in the first course because you need to reduce the dropout, but the problem is that you have intelligent students with different. Yes, and the problem is to try to understand for students that this is good for you. Because to introduce an active method, for me, is better in the third or fourth course. Because then you have the motivation, the intrinsic motivation of the student, because they are focused in the career. And they want to finish their studies and then all systems that can help them to improve the final marks or to reduce the time limitation, final activity is better for them. Then they have this motivation to act with an active methodology. In the first course, I think that we have a problem. I am doing class in the first course, and the problem is, okay, we try to do an active classroom, okay, we try to do a ramification, we try to do and the student says, oh my god, what is this? Is it necessary? We could, for example, in this case, in this year, we have introduced a voluntary 3 hours tutoring and practice with the support of the teacher to develop the, in this case, a computer tools practice. And they say, but these 3 hours in the afternoon is too much, and then we don't want to go to the class, and I will try what you prefer to develop the practice in my house. Okay. But in your house, you don't have the teacher and support, or some volunteer to ask and to solve and type of do. This is first course. In the second, third course, you have a volunteer, and you have an acute to ask. Our problems.
Yes, I would say that teacher at the first course act as a tutor.
Yeah.
Because it is a test subject, so students struggle to see why values or algebra, why they are important for their career. So as an engineer, they need to suffer those courses in order to get I work in the math department, so I know what the problem is.
One of our tries is to convince them that the subject is very important for them, also because it's a good predictor for any success in general, not only for mathematical subjects, but for physics or for structure or something like that. It's a good predictor to all the trajectory of this student along their career. So one of our works is to convince them. This is not a very good process for all the rest of the world we are trying for. Sometimes we have a problem. We need to filter that students and they don't continue. So we have a lot of students that are not concerned with this career.
Okay.
Some
questions, more questions?
The courses would be Spanish, Spanish.
To advise you, Miguel sent me that remember that this afternoon at 8 p.m. This is the cultural visit that we have in the location of Leon. You have in your program in a separate sheet the point of location, the meeting point, to this afternoon, and then we will have a visit to the population of León, more about 1 hour, and then we will go walking to the dinner bar that is very near, very close to the population that is located in the center of León. Okay? If you don't have a talk with the front desk about the dinner bar, please take speak with them to start the place, okay? And our technical boy, Mr. Yes, we have a final video, and there is no problem because I don't know whether you want to. Because all the image and all the photos, I think, that are inside of the team in the Twitter, I have. We try to look out.
Applying was pre-project questionnaire to GDT where you use a sample and the content contrasted with the dimensions of intercultural competence, past project questionnaire, and finally interviews were carried out. Results obtained with the content analysis technique. The dialogue analysis reflects less traces of the dimensions of intercultural competence. Just at the beginning, every development of the cognitive dimension is appreciated. Most of the messages were shorter focused on the project resolution. The analysis of the questionnaire results are about the development of the dimensions, cognitive, affective, and behavioral.
This is an aromatic pause. Maybe the flow of the. But
no,
the affective and cognitive dimensions were developed moderately. The factors that affect these results are an instructional design with few tasks and activities oriented to the development of cognitive elements, the interest for knowing the culture of the classmates, or reflections of the similarities and differences with other cultures, adapted, and short deadlines to deliver project advances. Also, the participants focus on the resolution of the task instead of knowing the lifestyle of other people and presenting their culture to others. Data analysis of the questionnaire. The behavioral dimension was the least developed, probably due to the preference of the use of tics that just allow verbal communication. Regarding the learning context elements, the teacher role, activities, interactions, and technology mediation, it's mandatory to contribute to intercultural competences. According to the results, most students consider that there was a lack of promotion of an effective intercultural communication that fostered knowledge of the culture's similarities and differences. Regarding interaction, spaces to favor an effective climate for interaction was missing. Regarding technology mediation, most prefer to use communication tools such as WhatsApp and email. A minimum percentage use video conference. The answers of the interviews revealed that students perceive the exercise as mechanical. The task is limited to the project accomplishment, so there's not much time to share with classmates. The quantitative and qualitative results analysis allow to conclude that these six elements may favor the development of the CI dimensions of projects using GDT with pedagogical purposes. Activities and tasks oriented to foster cognitive elements development, which create curiosity, openness, and willing to evaluate their own values. Foster reflection, so intercultural experiences are not left just as cultural shock. The trainer in this type of projects must turn into an intercultural guide. As students must be allowed to give information about the project parameters, including the communication expectations, as well as the final shape of the project. Motivate the GDT to use the technological tools that allow an explicit communication process such as Skype and video conferences. The assessment must be metacognitive. It must be a process instead of a product. These elements will increase interaction, interconnection, spontaneity, interchange, knowledge, and intercultural enrichment that this didactic strategy. Otherwise, it will tend to develop more the professional competences rather than the intercultural ones.